Hello, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Hola, buenas tardes a todos. Gracias por estar aquí y haber escogido esta tan interesante sesión sobre las estrategias y programas para gestionar el estrés y los riesgos psicosociales en el trabajo. Brevemente voy a introducir la sesión. Me llamo Francisco Jesús Álvarez Hidalgo y soy de la Comisión Europea. Creo que va a ser una sesión bastante interactiva y me gustaría comenzar, antes de presentar a las personas que me acompañan, a hablar de por qué la gestión del estrés y los riesgos psicosociales no únicamente está ligado con los empleadores, sino que también con los legisladores expertos y socios sociales, que todos tienen un papel clave a la hora de prevenir y reducir los costes para Europa, los trabajadores y los Estados miembros. Esta sesión interactiva tendrá en cuenta los distintos papeles y responsabilidades de aquellos que influencian a la prevención. El público se les pide que estén involucrados de forma activa, proporcionando respuestas a una serie de preguntas que se plantearán a lo largo del debate. Verán cómo funciona en breve. A lo largo de esta sesión queremos debatir los distintos aspectos en mayor detalle. La legislación, el cumplimiento y el rol de la inspección laboral, los enfoques sectoriales, las disposiciones de apoyo profesional, como por ejemplo de psicólogos, y la motivación para tomar acciones. Ahí existen algunos aspectos que me gustaría comentar al público. Las preguntas queremos que hagan surgir un debate y se les pedirá que utilicen esto para dar las respuestas y, por supuesto, estas respuestas serán anónimas. Y, por supuesto, habrá traducción en distintos idiomas, en castellano y francés. Creo que hemos visto los canales en la transparencia anterior. Así que, para las personas que van a hablar a continuación, me gustaría decir que, por favor, les pido que sean concisos y breves, 3 o 4 minutos para cada presentación. Y ahora ya me gustaría pasar a introducir a los miembros de este panel. Y comenzaré con Charlotte de Moulin, que trabaja para el Servicio de Empleo Público Federal del Ministerio de Trabajo de Bélgica. Así que allí trabaja como especialista en la prevención de riesgos psicosociales en el trabajo y están preparando la nueva legislación belga sobre riesgos psicosociales. Lars Lismos, y me disculpo por no pronunciar adecuadamente su nombre, trabaja en el entorno del trabajo en Dinamarca, donde transfieren conocimiento sobre los riesgos psicosociales y lo pasan a la práctica, al cumplimiento, y trabajan también en su comunicación.
De ese riesgo de nouvelles.
Swedish Teachers Union. He has been active for a decade in the ETUCE project on stress, violence and harassment in the education sector. Stefan Coigny is a businessman and chair of the Association of Belgian Hairdressers, and from next year, the General Secretary of COIFUR, the European Employers Group in the hairdressing sector. Veronica Jackl is an industrial and organizational psychologist in Austria, carrying out interventions on war-related stress in private companies and also in public organizations. And last but not least, Lucas Weber, who is a cultural psychologist and head of product development at Health Promotion Switzerland. He is specialized in occupational health management and mental health promotion. So with this panel, we will already start with the first trial question to test you to test the voting pads. The question is, what is your background, your personal background? As you see, you have several options here. One, labor inspection. Two, government representative. Three, OSH services and insurance. Four, worker representative. Five, employer representative. And six, other. You will have around 10 seconds to vote through your pads, and the vote can start right now. So you take the, you see the time passing. And we will see now the results. Majority of government representatives, interesting, followed by other. Very briefly, what the others are, for instance, some of the other respondents. Others? Research? Psychologist Association? Non-government NGO. Okay. You see that 17% worker representative, labor inspection the same, 17%, and or service or insurance, 10%. Okay, we have already a first overview of the composition of the session. And we will directly start to go to the first question. And the question will be put in a second here. And the question is very bluntly, do we need a specific legislation for improving psychosocial risk prevention in companies? And the possible answers are one, yes, definitely. Two, only for violence and harassment. Three, no, we have enough law and information as it stands. And four, it will be other. So you can start voting right now for 10 seconds. Let's see the replies. Yes, definitely. 60% of you consider that is necessary, more legislation. 24% consider not necessary. And 10%, interesting, only for violence and harassment, new legislation will be necessary. Well, I think now I will turn to Charlotte. Charlotte, from Belgium, where legislation has been changed recently. What were the changes about this change, and what was the thinking behind these changes?
Please. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, in Belgium, it's now a big year that we have a new specific legislation on psychosocial risk at work. And for us, it was the logical evolution on the field. Where the previous legislation of 2007 was insisted on harassment at work and the procedures to denounce it. We had only a few principles about what we called psychosocial risks, but it was general principles and was not very useful for the companies. So in 2010, 2011, we made an evaluation of this previous legislation, one evaluation by the ministry. We spoke with everybody, with all actors in the field, prevention advisors, but also labor inspection, the lawyers in the field, and also the judges and so on, and to know the good and bad points of the previous legislation. And also the parliament made also an evaluation, but it's not common in Belgium. And the parliament made also a recommendation on the field. So it was logical to have a new law because actors were expecting an evolution in the law. And what was very clear in this evaluation was that the harassment procedure was used to denounce other psychosocial risks at work, like stress, burnout, and also organizational issues in the companies, and also, of course, conflicts and so on. So there was really a lack of procedures in the field and also of prevention in the companies. So it was also the way with the new law to introduce the debate into the companies about psychosocial risks between committees for prevention and protection at work or workers and employers. It was the good way to introduce this in the companies. So more concretely, 4 points in the new legislation. The objective was to integrate psychosocial risk in the global prevention policy of the companies. So now the employers have to do a risk analysis on psychosocial risk and not only on health and safety at work. So now they have to do it also for psychosocial risk before any incident. So we say a priori. This is huge. Another new thing, very important, new. Now 1/3 of the workers' representative in the Committee for Prevention and Protection at Work or a member of the hierarchy can ask to the employer to do a risk analysis on psychosocial risk on a particular situation, on a particular work situation. For example, in a department, if a chief or a workers' delegation notice that something goes wrong, there are a lot of absenteeism or turnover, a huge turnover with the workers, it may be the occasion to do a risk analysis particular for this department. So it's also, of course, the way to avoid more problems later with the workers, between the workers. So we have also now individual procedures open to all psychosocial risks, not only for harassment as before. So now a worker can go to the prevention advisor specialized in psychosocial risks and introduce a request of intervention for psychosocial risks. A very long appellation, a very long name, request of intervention of psychosocial risk, but the objective was to avoid the term complaint. It was the workers were expecting too much sanction with this word, so we have changed also the terminology in the law. We have also defined in the law what are the psychosocial risks, because we have to be clear what we are talking about, and also to be juridically correct in the law, we have to define the terms we use. Finally, I would say that we have still a procedure for violence and harassment at work because of the severity of those facts, of those acts, and the workers are protected against dismissal, have a special protection against dismissal for in these procedures. That's the four important points of our new legislation. Thank you.
Many thanks to you, dear Charlotte, very clear, to the point. And we have some room for questions and comments from you. Any question or comment about this experience in Belgium? Rebecca, please. I think you will have this.
Rebecca Smith from Business Europe, the European Employers Organisation and coordinator of the Employers Group here in the agency. Thank you for telling us a bit more about the legislation. One question I had, because it's an issue that we discuss often amongst employees is that you said that you obviously had to define in the legislation what you mean by psychosocial risks. And one thing that we hear quite often is it's quite difficult for employers to distinguish between about the root causes of the psychosocial risk. So do they happen at the workplace or outside the workplace? Because, of course, a lot of stress is caused outside the workplace as well. Is there any way that you, within your legislation in defining psychosocial risks, that you dealt with this? Because clearly, of course, we know employers have an obligation to deal with psychosocial risks caused at the workplace. A lot of employers do extra things to deal with, I suppose, workplace health promotion, those kind of issues, but they don't have a legal obligation to do that. Was this discussed when you were discussing your legislation? And are there any, I suppose, safeguards within it to make sure that the employer's obligation is clear? Thank you.
Please.
Yes, we have a definition in the law. It was very complicated to write it. We work with the psychologist of the promotion of well-being at work, a department of the ministry, and the lawyer. We check it in a legally point of view. It was very complicated. I can say it if you want, but we insisted on five big important thing: work organization, working conditions, work content, living condition at work, and interpersonal relationship at work, the social relation. It was the five big points in the definition. And yes, the employer must have an impact on those things. It was also a condition. Things from the private life, of course, are not considered in a psychosocial risk at work, but it has to be said in the definition too, to protect the employers. And what else? And it's also the situation is must be abnormal for all workers placed in the same situation. It was also an important condition. I don't know if I answer to the question. I can give you the correct definition if you want later.
Thank you, Charlotte. It was another question here.
Hello, Susan Flocken from the European Trade Union Committee for Education. We'll have a short presentation here, so I will not speak too long. But we're doing a project on decent workplaces at the moment, looking in the education sector in particular. And we went to Belgium just last week on a case study. And I wanted to ask, I want to congratulate you really on this piece of legislation. It's really interesting, and in particular the definition, which is a good example, good practice. My question is about the tools, concrete tools that you have given social partners, but also in general, to implement actually this new legislation. If you could give some details about that. Thank you.
We have in our internet site a toolbox. Oh, sorry. We have in our internet site a toolbox, what we call a toolbox, with many tools for the committees for prevention and protection at work, for manager, for now there is a new for the very small enterprise to help them in this matter, which is very complicated for. I don't work in this department, but we have a lot of things in the internet site. And we don't have anything specific for the public sector, but I think it can be used, what we have on the internet site, www.employmentbelgium.be, something like that.
Aida, and then...
Excuse me. Thank you very much, Charlotte. Aida Ponce del Castillo from the European Trade Union Institute in Brussels. My question is about the part of the law that focuses on prevention. So I understand that you just highlighted the objective and the procedural part and the tools, but what is the part of the law that focuses and describes prevention as a guiding principle? Thank you.
Yes, as I've just said, there is now the obligation to make a risk analysis on psychosocial risk a priori. This is the first line of prevention, and also the new tools for the member of the committee of the hierarchy to ask for a risk analysis to the employer of a specific work situation. This is the two main prevention tools that we have in the legislation. Yes. So to always to take into consideration the psychosocial risk in the company.
Thank you, Charlotte. There is time for one more question. The last one, please. Here.
Thank you. Ivan Williams from IOSH in the UK. Yes, my question is about training and education. Lack of specific training in psychosocial risk has already been defined as one of the main lacks of the system. I would like to know how Belgian legislation is dealing with that issue in, I don't know, OSH practitioners, labor inspection, even regulators. Thanks.
Yes, we have guides. We have developed guides for the member of the committees for prevention and protection at work, with simply words explaining what are psychosocial risks. And also for the manager and employer, because also they maybe don't know what are psychosocial risks. We work here in the Ministry of Labor for the work environment for the workers and the employers, not in the educational, more in general. So I don't work on that field. But we try to develop concrete and easy tools for the work world.
Thank you very much, Charlotte. It's time to pass to the next point, and we will start as usual by the question. And the questions, I think you will see that immediately in the screen. I hope so. Okay. The question is here. It is possible to create a good psychosocial work environment at a working place through inspection and enforcement? And the options, the categories for answers you have is one, yes, definitely. Two, it depends on the circumstances. Three, no, it's not possible. And four, other. And you can vote right now for 10 seconds. So, the it depends is in this case the most prevalent or frequent reply, very closely to yes, definitely. So, and no, is not possible, has been chosen by one-fourth of you. So, this is a good introduction of the next speaker. Our colleague Lars Lidsmoes, the Danish Labour Inspectorate has extensive experience in targeting psychosocial risk in inspections. Could you please elaborate a little bit on that,
yes. Lars? Thank you. Well, I'm happy to say that I agree with the majority of the participants today. It is a very complex thing to inspect psychosocial work environment, and I'm sure that we could talk at length about how to do it. But I would like to list some prerequisites or some things, conditions that in our experience in Denmark that we have found that helps with creating a positive effect of inspection of psychosocial work environment problems. Just like Charlotte said a moment ago, there is a very important question about legislation. We have found that it is important that the provisions in Working Environment Act or in the executive orders under the Working Environment Act must address the relevant risk factors that you wish to inspect. Psychosocial working environment encompasses a lot of different risk factors, and it is important that the rules and the expectations of the authorities are made very clear to all the stakeholders in the company, to the companies, to the employers, and to the employees. As psychosocial working environment problems are very complex and abstract, it is very important that the rules are clear, or in the legislation, or is clarified in guidance materials, so that everybody knows what to expect from the authority. In Denmark, we have a long tradition of cooperation between authorities and social parties. Therefore, it has been very important for us that inspection of the psychosocial working environment is accepted and supported both politically by the politicians in government and also by the stakeholders and the social parties across both employer and employee organizations. It is very important that the Working Environment Authority is supported by these stakeholders in order to ensure acceptance and compliance both by employers and employees in companies. Then there's the question about what purpose is the inspection, and there are always several purposes when you inspect working environment problems or work, when you do inspection visits in a company. There is, of course, the purpose of control and enforcement of legal provisions and the protection of employees. And then there's the purpose of supplying information and advice to employers and employees on how to comply with the legal provisions and how to improve psychosocial working environments, the psychosocial working environment in the companies. In order to do this, the inspectors, when they visit the companies and the authority, should make sure that information about legal demands, about recommendations and advice is well understood by the employer as well as the employees or the employee representatives. That is a big challenge for inspectors when they visit the companies, and it should be addressed specifically by the authority. An important thing here is that everybody understands the severity of the risk to employees' health and safety. It is easy to describe and to explain that you can be seriously hurt if the machines in the company are not safe, but it is another job. It's another challenge to explain to all people in the company why it is important to have a good and safe psychosocial work environment. Um, This is very important in regards to the psychosocial work environment inspection, because if you write an improvement notice to a company, it usually solves, that is our experience, it will probably solve the problem it addresses, but it doesn't necessarily improve the working environment outside the scope of the improvement notice or in other sections of the company. There is no given proliferation or spreading of the effects of an improvement notice. Finally, inspections should motivate the companies to continually improve their psychosocial work environments. The improvement of a psychosocial work environment happens in the companies. It doesn't happen when inspection authorities are present. It is important to keep in mind that creating a good psychosocial working environment or improving a bad psychosocial working environment is a long-term process which has to be driven by employers and employees together. For inspection to be effective, the company must take responsibility for this process also after the working environment authority has left. In order to do that, our inspectors are trained to enter into a dialogue with the company representatives. We cannot tell the companies how to solve their problems, but we can offer general guidance and help them to reflect on how they can better their working environment. It is our experience that the combination of support and inspection is the best way for a working environment authority to help improve working conditions in companies. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lars Christian. Very clear and extensive information about that. We have time now for questions and debate. We will start right here.
Thank you very much for your concise presentation. My name is Michael Ertel. I'm working in the Federal Institute for Occupational Safety and Health in Germany. I've learned that in Denmark there is a strategy 2020 for the work environment, which has a very ambitious aim to reduce the number of employees who are psychologically overloaded by 20%. My question is, how is this strategic aim related to your inspection activities?
In Denmark, we have used research to identify the most important and severe risk factors in different sectors. And we have also isolated the sectors that are most prone to suffer from bad psychosocial work environment. We try to focus our inspection activities on the companies that have the most problems, and support them with both with inspection and guidance materials. So, in our national strategy, we focus on the most severe, the primary problems, and we focus our inspection strategy and activities on these specific companies and sectors in order to help bring down the number of people that are affected by bad psychosocial work environments.
Thank you. Here, please.
Thank you. I'm Johannes Siegrist from Germany, from the University of Düsseldorf. I think we have to congratulate your country for a forerunner in this important area. This is really impressive. My question is, because the final end is to improve the health and well-being of working populations, is there any evidence about evaluation results so that you can show that in these companies where you have improved the psychosocial work environment, that as a consequence, that some evidence is there that the health of employees has been improved as well?
I wish I could come with a positive answer to that question.
Unfortunately, the way we measure the effects of our inspection or the improvements in the companies are very large scale and global. We cannot isolate the effect of our inspection, or we haven't yet isolated the effect on our inspection to the specific companies or sectors that we have inspected. And we find that it would be rather difficult to do so because an improvement or worsening of the psychosocial environment, working environment, will also depend on a lot of other factors than our just our inspection. What we can see is that a part of our inspection strategy is to visit the companies repeatedly that have problems. If you get improvement notice from the Working Environment Authority, you will be visited again by the authority, and we see that the improvement notice actually helps with the specific problems, and that repeated visits and guidance help these companies. But on a national or large scale level, we unfortunately cannot document any specific effects.
Thank you, Lars Christian. Any other question, remark, or comment, please?
Yes, my name is Annemieke Wortman. I'm from the Netherlands, Ministry of Social Affairs. I have a very practical question. How much time and effort do your inspectors have to inspect and advise a company?
Well, that is it's difficult to say, but one thing is for sure, that inspection of a psychosocial working environment is much more time consuming than just any other inspections. So it is it does take longer time for the inspectors to probably assess the psychosocial working environment, and as they assess the psychosocial work environment and has to describe it very specifically if they issue an improvement notice. Also, the writing of improvement notices takes a long time. But we have some inspection activities where we visit companies and only focus on assessing psychosocial working environment, and that that usually takes about 1 to 2 days, full days. We use focus group interviews and observations, and then we have meetings with employee and employers when we first come to the company and also when we leave. I cannot be more specific than that, I'm afraid. Sure.
Thank you. We have time for one short question or comment, if you have. If not, yes, one short question, please.
My name is Anna Kucharska. I'm from National Labor Inspectorate of Poland, and I have the question, do all the inspectors do this kind of inspections of the psychosocial risk environment, or do you train some some inspectors who do these exact inspections?
When we recruit inspectors, all inspectors are recruited because they are specialists in some area about the working environment. They have one skill that they are specifically good at, and that we help them practice as they work with the Working Environment Authority. All inspectors are trained to be generalists in all areas. And that means that there are a large part of our inspectors that can that are trained to ask the right questions when they come in a company on a general inspection in order to clarify if there may or may not be a problem in the psychosocial work environment. Then we have specialist inspectors that are, most of them are psychologists that then visit the companies and make a deeper assessment of the psychosocial working environment. So no, not all inspectors are trained to make the full evaluation, and not all inspectors care to do it. It's not an area for everybody. Not everybody has the skill set, and not everybody have the motivation to do it.
Thank you very much for your questions and for your answers. And we will pass to the next question. And the question will be put now in the screen. You have it. Here, is a sectoral specific approach the most effective framework for intervention? And you can reply, one, yes, definitely. Two, it depends on the circumstances. Three, no. And four, other. And you can vote right now, for 10 seconds, please. Okay, in this case, it's a clear majority, a slight majority for, yes, definitely, about the sectoral specific approach, closely followed by it depends on the circumstances. And clear no is 1/5 of the 90% of the replies. So let's hear now from workers' and employers' perspective what can be reached by sectoral activities. And in this respect, Anders and Stefan will present their positions. Please.
Thank you. Do I need to speak now? I mean, the answer is given. So specific sectorial interventions are needed in the field of education. Basically, we need a general legal framework, but does not take us far. School needs to be intervened specifically since the type of work organization, the social life and the structure is very specific. Schools are also by far the largest workplace in Europe if you add pupils, children and students. It's also that the whole learning process that goes on in school has to be handled by the teaching profession, even if other stakeholders want to deal with it, and that's a part of the problem. The vision of a good working environment or educational environment should be born by the social partners. It is through the actions out of the social dialogue between the social partners that sustainable and healthy schools will develop. Actions to make school healthy, a healthy workplace, will always pay off in the long run. There will be less red figures in the balance sheet if you start that work. And this is already the case locally and nationally in around Europe, but it needs to be enlarged and deepened. It's the only way to get above this basic level made by the general framework. As already mentioned, the European Trade Union Committee for Education by itself and together with EFE, the European Federation of Education and Employers, has run several projects concerning healthy workplaces the last decade. ETUS is now running a project with employers on decent work and decent work and education. This includes, for example, case studies in Finland, Romania, and as we heard, in Belgium and in Spain. This aims to promote healthy workplaces as a ground for quality in education. It's working in a concrete and practical way to prevent and combat work-related stress in schools. Yes, we do indeed need special sectorial interventions in the field of education. That is my definite answer. But they already said that.
Okay, thank you, Anders. Stefan, please.
Okay. I was observing the room, and I saw everybody has hair on his head. So I suppose that everybody has his hairdresser. And from now on, I want that everybody of you, when he goes to the hairdresser, he looks in another way to the hairdresser, not only for his hair, but the security, the health, and the safety of the workers and the employer also in the hair salon. So yes, for me, definitely, the sector has to intervene in the specific approach for the for this matter. The latest European survey of the enterprises on the new emerging risk, ESNR2, shows that psychosocial risk have a huge impact on the operating expenses. This year in Belgium, the costs for the long-term illness will be higher than the costs for the unemployment benefits. Laws, regulations, royal decrees in Belgium, and collective bargaining agreements are encouraging employers to tackle the issue. It is important to provide the industry, the sector of the hairdressers, with tools to support them. We have the OIRA, the Online Interactive Risk Assessment. This tool is already used in Belgium for a part in the hairdresser sector. We all know that the risk assessment is the start of any good prevention policy, but we also know that there is room for improvement in terms of execution, implementation of the RA. An average of one or three companies in the hair sector is only using the risk assessment today. The industry has scope for actively promoting this tool and can encourage active hairdressers to fill in the risk assessment in partnership with education settings and external bodies such as external health and safety departments. For example, by organizing information sessions and workshops for students and active hairdressers, employers and employees. Support tools can provide added value. As the concept of risk assessment could deter the target group because they are afraid of the unknown. In Belgium, we have developed a procedure and a manual, digital and on paper, to facilitate this use and clarify its contents using practical tips and best practices. We made from the OIRA tool a very simple leaflet, and we give it to all the hairdressers in Belgium. We also have the manual, which is a little book, well, a book, well done, with pictures, text, and so on. Everything in function of the hairdresser sector. So it's important also to involve education settings because the risk assessment applies to trainees as well. It is the students, the future hairdressers, who then can inform their employers and encourage them to draw up the analyses. Employee involvement is crucial and necessary for the success of the enterprise and for the business of hairdressers and other business also. We need to change the mentality of both employers and employees. All parties need to realize that a good prevention policy is not an extra cost, but constitutes a win-win, which will benefit everyone over time. Employers will notice that involving staff in completing the RA, the risk assessment, incorporating points of attention and complying with the prevention measures will result in a less absenteeism over time. The working conditions are important, and especially for the hairdressers, labor differentiation and flexibility are influencing positively the quality of work. Talking to employers and giving them the opportunity to reflect on the internal organization of the work in their hairdressing salon can increase awareness about doing things differently. By giving them the opportunity to review the working environment, they will be more inclined to address certain situations as they are approached on the basis of their personal living and workspaces. Are they operating in balance with their working environment? Are tasks equally distributed? Do they work together well with their team? Is the work-life balance respected? The industry provides them with tools to work on unbalanced and unhealthy workload, as job rotation, more autonomy, flexible work times, together with the staff and as part of the job commitments, on the job training, part-time work, full-time workers, and so on. Do not underestimate the hairdresser's business. We also take a lot of attention to career coaching as well, which provides success and de-stress the workload and help everyone to have a good feeling in their job. Hairdressers not only require the basic supplies needed to run their salon, they also need to have the means to improve working quality and employee engagement. Information and training sessions can help to achieve this goal. This includes orientation of new staff, dealing with difficult clients, employee diversity, developing mentorship programs and training managers to manage diverse teams. In Belgium, in Flanders especially, hairdressers employers can take action with 50% co-funding to bolster their HR policy, with support of regional economic consultation committees, RESOC, and in consultation with the industry. In France, they have developed My Health Coach, and they are working on food and nutrition, on physical activities and TMS, and stress and sleep. It is the aim to practice the healthy lifestyle, throughout the day and not just at home. It is the reason why Institute of de la Coiffure in France wants to promote with this program a healthier lifestyle and thus better health by the professionals. I hope to have given you a view of the effectiveness in our approach as sector in the managing on stress and psychosocial risk at work. May I thank you for your attention and your involvement.
Thank you very much, Stefan.
Thank you.
On the basis of your very interesting presentations, we have now the opportunity to make comments and questions. You have the floor. Please.
Hello, my name is Terry Woolmer. I represent the manufacturing sector in the UK, so I'm very interested in this sectoral debate. However, although I represent the manufacturing sector, I see little value in developing specific guidance for one sector. when the strategies and the methodologies for dealing with psychosocial factors are basically identical in whatever sector you're trying to deal with the problem. So I don't see really see the merit in specific sectoral guidance. I see the examples of how to apply it for particular sectors. And I suppose I'm really interested about how the OEVA risk assessment process for hairdressers addresses psychosocial risk factors. So I'm interested in the OEVA risk assessment and specifically what psychosocial risk factors it deals with and how it actually addresses those issues.
It's a very difficult question for a hairdresser, but I try to answer. Yes, I try to answer, okay? If I understood the question well, is that you want to know how we implement the risk assessment into the hairdresser sector or in the hair salons? Very well, they deal very good. I mean, one on three hairdresser salons with employees practice that OEVA tool. And we help them as sector, we have some sectoral consultant that goes to the hairdresser and help him to fill in the OEVA tool. If is that an answer to your question? Okay. So well, you know, we are working with people, on people, and for people. The psychosocial risk that we have in the hair sectors is that you are confronted with all parties into the hair salon. It's not like in a factory. In a factory, you only have the employer and the employee working together. We have the client near the employee and the employer. So that risk is big because you have to have a certain attitude to the client, to the customers. And that's a very heavy point that must be learned at school in the beginning so that they can develop on the workflow afterwards.
Thank you very much, Stefan. Maybe regarding OEVA and in connection with the question from Terry Vollmer, maybe you, Julia, can explain something about the how OEVA works in this particular case. Please, here.
Thank you. OEVA is not meant for as a psychosocial risk assessment tool, but what OEVA does is it reaches the small and medium-sized companies and it highlights the importance to deal with psychosocial risk. So we try to encourage our OEVA partners, as the hairdressers, for example, to put questions in there saying, do you have a strategy on how to deal with stress? Or work distribution is when doing work distribution, aspects of psychosocial risk assessment or work overload are taken care of. I cannot like tell you the exact wording of the hairdressers, but the idea of the tool is to point out, look at this issue and have it in mind and involve the workers, and then the tool also links to other websites or to other tools. So OEVA is not meant as a psychosocial risk assessment tool, but OEVA is meant to go to reach the small companies and to make them aware there's an area you have to take care of. And to prepare the ground, for example, by having a strategy on how to deal with psychosocial risk or with stress in the company. Okay?
Okay, thank you, Julia, for this clarification. We have 1 minute for a short question. I think you have one, and 1 minute for a reply. Please, go ahead.
Michael Attel from Bauer. My question is more country-specific. I've learned that just, I think, 6 weeks ago, there have been new regulations in Sweden on the social and organizational working environment. How would you say these regulations be helpful also for the hairdressing sector, but also all to the other sectors which are affected by psychosocial risks?
Okay. There is a similar development in Sweden as in Belgium, but in that way, we don't use the word psychosocial anymore. We just use organization and social working environment. And that is the basic for going further on. Of course, there is a general base on moving on, but we have, for example, in Sweden, a national gathering for working environment in school with the government, with the employers, and with the unions. And this is out of that discussion. So that has increased and deepened the discussion about working environment in school and educational environment. I mean, if you take the whole, I mean, we have since 25 years, all the pupils and students are subject to the working environment law, and they can, offer, when they are in the seventh grade, appoint their own secure health and safety representatives. So this is something we have worked on for a long time, but it's just another way to grow.
Thank you very much. So we can go to the next question. And in introducing the question, let me tell you something. In SNR, in the results of SNR, there is a big variance between 4 and 60% in the use of psychologists for psychosocial risk prevention in the different member states. On the basis of this big variance, the question is, should there be greater provision of professional support by psychologists? And you can reply, one, yes, where possible. Two, perhaps decisions should be taken jointly by the employer and employee representatives. Three, no. And four, other. You can vote right now for 10 seconds, please. So, majority of yes were possible, followed closely by perhaps decisions should be taken jointly by the employer and employee representative, and one out of ten is a clear no about the greater provisions of professional support by psychologists. Veronica, you are our Austrian psychologist. And you have something to let us know in this respect. Please.
Thank you very much.
You are welcome.
Hello. The answers of you make me very happy. Thank you very much. For the great majority who also says there should be a greater support by psychologists. I am a freelance psychologist, working psychologist, and I also support companies and all the institutions to help to get these psychosocial risk assessment. And when I go into companies and I see the staff and talk to them, every time they have a little bit of fear or more fear when they see there's a psycho professional coming into the company, and they're very afraid because the employees are afraid they're getting being analyzed like Dr. Freud, and the employers are also a little bit afraid and they don't know, okay, what can a psychologist do here with my company and with my workplaces. And there's also really strange views what a psychologist does in such a project and what we do when we set interventions. Employers are also afraid that I will insist on every absurd idea the staff comes up with. Like when the staff says in a workshop, we all need parking spaces for everyone, and that's what a stress factor every morning. And then the employers are very afraid that I will insist that everybody needs a parking space. But that's not a fact. And I have to clear this up, that this is not my propose to set here through all these wishes. So it's very important for me that also the employers and the employees, they have both a good feeling when working with a psychologist, that it's very clear for them what we do, what are the purpose of such a project is. Because I have the staff always always involved with a survey, or I see them in an interview or in a workshop, And I also have the employers because they pay me, and they also need to have very good feeling when working with me. I think professional support is very important to get an objective view on the workplaces. And it's easier also for the companies to focus on these psychosocial working conditions and not on individual complaints. You have to defer this. And it's also easier for them with professional support to set condition-focused measures and not just like, okay, maybe we should do some training. And that's just the global perspective everybody comes up with. But you need to have professional support to set really good and effective measures and to help you to get a view from outside. And it's also easier for me than from someone who is in the company to speak openly about problems. Because I can talk nearly about every stress factor because I see them from a different point of view than the staff does or the supervisors do. And that also helps within such a project to keep a clear view on these psychosocial risks. Yes, in Austria the law changed 2 years ago, 2013, basically like in Belgium they did. And now it's also explicitly these psychosocial risks included. And from this day on, a lot of professions also get basic training for this psychosocial risk assessment, not only the psychologists, but also the occupational health doctors or safety officers. And that's very important in my point of view, because I think that's a good way to get the knowledge into the companies, because these other professions are often permanently integrated into the company, and they also have the respect of the company owner, for example. And then it's easier to transport our message. And then when they have a very complex problem or when the project is very big, then comes to the point when they add a psychologist to the project. I also understand that not every employer wants to buy a psychologist because they also have to spend the money on them for such projects. But after every project I did, really after everyone, the managers told me that they were very happy about it. They get a very deep insight into the company, into their own company, and they really know more about their own company than they did before. And it was also better because they cleared now what stress factors are within the workplaces or have been. So for me, it's a very clear yes. The provision of psychosocial help from a psychologist is a good thing. And maybe it's a first step to get transported the message via the other professions which are already in the companies.
Thank you, Veronica, on this interesting... Thank you very much. Questions, comments, or remarks about this important topic? Please.
Thank you. My question would be, we had the presentation of the labor inspector, right? Mm. And that's based on legislation, so going to the workplace and looking, is this workplace following the law or not? Mm. Should things be changed? So what is your leverage as a psychologist when you come to workplace? I don't, you started explaining it, but I would like to hear more about this. What is your leverage that you have? Because you're not, in the end, if the company follows this or not, there's no legal obligation then, you know, your report, or is there? I don't know whether there is, but to implement what you see, right, and to apply. Yeah.
Okay. In Austria, the whole responsibility lies within the company. So the labor inspectorate comes also to the companies and talk to them if they have to do something very special or if they also have addressed already these psychosocial risks. And if they see a lack here in the risk assessment, then they tell the company, okay, you have to do this risk assessment on psychosocial risks. And then the company has to see whether they have the knowledge to do it by themselves, or if they know, for example, an OSH doctor who can do this for them, or if they have the need for a psychologist. And that's when I come into the companies, then I will help them to do this risk assessment. And I'll also help them to go with the project. In the end, I can also give them advices. But in the end, it's all to the supervisors and the company owners to do so. And also to the labor inspectorate to say, okay, you have to follow these advices, or you can also do something different if you think that this would be better. But there's the obligation to do something about it and to assess all these psychosocial risks.
Thank you, Veronica. Next one, please.
Thank you, Veronica. I totally agree with you.
Thanks.
But could you please give us some examples of intervention programs after assess the psychosocial risks?
Mm-hmm. The measures afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
The measures after such a psychosocial risk assessment are very often very small and absolutely without costs. Often it's about getting the work organized differently, to talk openly about the work organization or what the tasks are or how the tasks are also here within a team. That's a very big part of it. Sometimes we see that there is some training needed because there are special situations the staff can't deal with, but that's just a small part of it. Mostly it's about organizing work better.
Thank you. We have time for one more question. Rebecca, please.
Thank you. As you mentioned, of course, this has a cost for the employers, particularly smaller companies. Mm. And I was wondering, how do you convince them that they need you, I suppose, is the question.
Yeah.
How do you show them, I suppose, in from a qualitative, but I guess also from a sort of spending point of view, that the cost can be outweighed by the benefits that they can have afterwards. And perhaps related to that, of course, in some cases, these issues are dealt with by health and safety representatives, but they can also be dealt with by human resources managers. Or I'm also thinking in larger companies where it's not a legislative obligation, it may also be dealt with by corporate social responsibility departments. Yeah. Who do you link up with most, and where do you see differences in terms of the route that you go through within the company? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, for the first question, for the cost, that's a very hard part. You can tell them from the numbers we heard before in the session, that there is, from a scientific point of view, it's very obvious that it gets in the cost. The return on investment is very high for these psychosocial risks if you assess them and get interventions. But for most company owners, that's like, okay, scientific cloud. They can't go there. So mostly you have to have someone within the company who has a feeling for this topic, and also sees that there is a need to do something. Maybe they have a very high turn-on rate or a very high days of sickness days. Then they see that they need to do something. Or if the stuff changes very often, then it's also something where they see, maybe there's something going wrong and it has nothing to do with the other risk assessment they already did. And then it's easier for them to see the advantages of buying a psychologist and my services. But often it's the managers who see it just afterwards, after the program and after the project. They see what it was all about. And then it's also easier to get the mouth-to-mouth feedback. And then one company owner says, okay, I did this and it was very good, and tell this to the others. Or also, as you mentioned, the HR professionals, they're also linking up together, and then they also can tell about that there was a very good project they did, and then it's easier for them. You also asked to which professions I'm linked up within the company. That's very different. With all the projects, there are mostly HR representatives, the safety officers, or also the doctors. Sometimes, as you mentioned, corporate social responsibility professionals also had them too. So it's very diverse by now.
Okay, thank you very much for your questions and for your replies, Veronica. And we can go for the next question, a difficult one, about motivation, because we all know that it's important to take action in regarding psychosocial risks, but what really motivates employers to take action with regard to this issue, to psychosocial risk prevention? And you can reply, one, financial incentives, for instance, reduced insurance premiums. Two, awareness of cost and damage. Three, financial penalties. And four, other. You can vote right now. 10 seconds to this important question. And we see that there are two main majority replies: financial penalties and strong motivation. And in a less penalty tone, awareness of cost and damage, followed by financial incentives, only 13%, and other, a small 5%. Well, in this respect, your country, Switzerland, Lucas, has set up a program to enhance employers' motivation by providing information on cost. From your organization, Health Promotion Switzerland, what is your message, Lucas?
Thank you very much. Health Promotion Switzerland is a foundation. We are active in the field of public health, health promotion and prevention, and our funding is defined by the law, so we have our funding is public. One thing we do is that we show employers that chronic stress is bad for business. So chronic stress is bad for business. So we made a survey last year, a representative survey, and we could show that 24.8% of employees in Switzerland have critical working conditions related to stress. And at the same time, we could show that the stress-related costs for the employers are in total about 5 million euro. So this is about 1,000 euro per employee in the mean. And let me explain what we did. We developed an index, and it's called the Job Stress Index, and it's one single figure which shows how much the working conditions are stressful. So it's a relationship between stressors and resources. And it's, of course, if you take the whole working conditions related to stress and you put all in one number, you do a big simplification. But it's very useful to talk with managers if you have some simplifications. But the interesting thing is that this job stress index we looked if it's how it is related to other stress-related factors, and it is significantly related to exhaustion. It's one thing, and with health problems, with it is related with psychosomatic disorders or with sleeping problems. And at the same time, and this is more interesting for employers, if you have a higher job stress index, you also have less job satisfaction, you have less commitment to the organization, and now it becomes more interesting, you have more turnover intention. And we went also one step further, and we could show that this job stress index is related with a higher absence rate and with productivity losses. So we did this analysis with universities, the University of Bern and the University of Zurich, and we did last year, 2014, a representative study in Switzerland, and we used these figures to show if you have more chronic stress, you will have more productivity losses. And this relationship is also from the point of view of the scientific point of view clear. And now we have also a tool which we offer to employers. It's called the S tool, and it's a tool to measure stress and to measure this job stress index. And what we tell to employers is it is worth to measure stress and the conditions that related to stress, and at the same time it is worth to better the situation related to stress. And one thing we can calculate it as 1 point in the job stress index is worth about 400 euros per employee. So, you know, if you better the conditions in related to stress, you will have less productivity losses. But we talk always about the employer's point of view and the losses for the employer. We are not talking about costs, externalized cost of stress. This will be another team. So if I tell you 5 million of euro for Switzerland, it's the costs related for the employers because of absences and because of productivity losses caused by stress.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Lucas. And we have now the opportunity to raise some comments and/or questions. We will start by you, Terry.
Thank you for that. Very interested in the job stress index. Can you tell me if it differentiates between work-related stress factors and other factors where someone comes to work, maybe going through a divorce, their dog may have died that morning, whatever it may have been? Do you actually make a differentiation, or do you actually take all those stress factors into account?
Thank you very much for this question. That's something we analyzed, and we're still analyzing it, because we do now these surveys yearly. So we will also have longitudinal data, which is very interesting. We did it first time in 2014, and this year we did it another time. And what we do is with regression analysis, we take out we can tell private stressors, and we calculate what is the effect of the job stress. And it's scientifically complicated to do this, but since last year we took other factors that could be private stressors, as an example, how stressful is your way from home to your work. And so we also asked people how stressful is it, and then we calculate this effect out. And we can say that there is a part of the stress which is private, is existing, and it's also you also feel it at work, but there is also part which is working stress, and we can calculate all the rest out, and there is still something. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lucas. Another question here, please.
Mm-hmm. On that, I have more of a comment. Does it make sense to separate private, the stress you have at home in private life from workplace? Don't you come as a person, a whole person, to your workplace, and you are that person with your stress you have in your private life, and you'll have it at your workplace. You'll be thinking about it, and vice versa.
Very good question. We try our one of our goals is to activate investments of employers in the health of their employees. And what employers often say is, this stress is private. So why should we do anything? And that's why we also look at this part, with the job stress, in order to show that there is a field where the employee has possibility to action, and we show what he can do. And there's also, it's clear, there's also another part, but I think we at the moment we try to show that there's something to do with the working conditions also. And this is what we say to employers. And I think one important result is that at the end it is worth for the employers to do something for against psychosocial risks and for better mental health. And the figures are clear. So I think we should work in the direction that the employers also measure their stress situation in order that they can see what the effects are in their company.
Thank you, Lucas. Other questions or comments? We have still one over there, please.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I'm Christine Loos. I'm the director of PSIA in Spain. My question would be, what do you think are the new trends, new challenges that the companies are facing regarding psychosocial risk? Or what's the next step?
I think we know a lot about stress and how to measure, but we should know more about what to do against it. And I think we should investigate much more the what are the good interventions and what are the interventions that are where the cost and the effects are the best. And this is something we can learn all together, but it's also something which the company has to learn for himself. So you should know, if you are an employer, you should know what are the factors that are relevant for the whole company, for the different sectors of a company, for the different teams, and know and learn how to deal with it, how to better the situation. And I think it's about interventions now. And there's another thing I wanted to point out as I saw this question. We talk a lot about risks and about the costs of stress, and I think we should talk more about the potential of mental health. Because if we found ways to better the engagement and better the motivation of employees, this will be a lot more effective also on in money, in gains, than only to take out the risks or the costs. So I think it's also about health promotion and mental health promotion.
Thank you very much. The last one is for you.
Thank you.
your approach, which is very operational, is it in some way related to activities or actions by the labor inspectorate in Switzerland?
We have our role is in this part of actions which are optional. And there is another organization, the SECO in Switzerland, which is working on with inspectors and also to make sure that the legislation is the companies also follow the legislation, and so we are in contact, but we have not the same role. But I think we need both. We need obligation on the one side, and we also can show that there is an option to do more and that it's worth to do also more.
Thank you. We have still time for one more question. Boyle, please. Over there.
Boyle Callimore, Swedish Work Environment Authority. It's actually more a general comment. First of all, I want to thank you all for a very interesting session. I've learned a lot. Anders Eklund had earlier a question about the Swedish legislative initiative, so I would just like to say two words about that. The psychosocial risks are from before covered in the Swedish Work Environment Act. That is nothing new, and you didn't say that either. But in September, the Swedish Work Environment Authority adopted new regulation regarding the organizational and social work environment. And we have high expectation on those provisions. The main target is, of course, to reduce the work-related illness caused by psychosocial risks. And the strategy is to address the questions, the problems on a strictly organizational level. And the provision, they focus on workload, the balance between demands and resources, as we heard before, very similar to Belgium. Thank you very much for your presentation. Working hours and victimization. And the new provisions, they will come into force the 31st of March next year. So I just wanted you to know this about the initiative. Thank you very much.
Thanks to you, Boyle, for this very, very interesting piece of information, which is really useful in the context of our discussion. Now it's time for a summary and for wrap-up of this very, very interesting session. Thank you to all of you and to your interventions. I will try to make a short summary of what was mentioned here. A lot of information, but trying to focus in the most important elements. Across Europe, there are many initiatives on psychosocial risks, from legislation to inspection campaigns, provision of tools to motivational approaches. Stakeholders in member states can and hopefully will learn and be inspired by each other. And this discussion is a good example of that. Regarding the topic of legislation, some countries like Belgium and like Sweden have adopted legislative measures regarding psychosocial risks. And in our discussion, it came out that one of the main challenges of the legal approach is to have an appropriate definition of the topics to be dealt with. The approach should be focused on prevention. Prevention is the key element in these legal initiatives. And certainly, employers and workers really need tools useful tools and practical tools for implementation. Regarding inspection, we see that there are different approaches and different initiatives on inspection, and measurements of inspection impact is difficult. Psychosocial work environment depends on much more than inspection, but improvement notices and repeated visits and guidance, good and practical guidance, is really useful and helps to reach these objectives. Regarding the sectoral interventions, it is clear that social partners need to be involved in interventions. Sector interventions raise performance above the baseline, whether the intervention is focused on tools, on publications, or on trainings. Involving educational settings is important in this changing of prevention culture, in particular in the sectoral approach, and in particular in small companies. The changing of the culture needs a lot of education and specific actions in this respect. Very interesting reflection about the psychologist support in companies. I noticed that after receiving advice on possible intervention from a psychologist point of view, managers usually have a very deep and useful insight into their own companies. It's a good way of knowing better what is happening and what is going on in the organizations. Support of a psychologist helps to find the right measures in the organization. And mostly measures focus on organizing work differently and often don't go along with cost. Usually only the fact of being able to openly discuss about organizational measures is something very positive for companies. About motivation, it was very interesting to know and to see that stress and psychosocial risk have a cost, a very substantial and sometimes enormous cost for companies. Regardless of the source of stress, it is clear that it's very costly for businesses. Showing that the element that this is very costly can in itself motivate employers. The more chronic the stress is in companies, the more cost it represents for them. And there are, it can be useful to use effective tools to measure the stress. This was a part of our very fruitful discussions. And with the positive message I would like to conclude is that it is possible and it is necessary to act in these regards, in psychosocial risks. We have learned different experiences, different approaches in this respect, and the positive message is that stress and psychosocial risks can be effectively managed. My last word is to say many, many thanks to all of you for the very interesting presentations and for the very interesting questions and remarks. Thank you very much.